Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today and to feel the presence of one who loves us, one who will do anything for us to see that we're saved. Sometimes I think the Lord wants to see us saved more than we want to see ourselves. Amen. I really believe that.
Right.
You can be seated this morning. Won't you testify? I'm letting my wife say something. And I say most of the things during our preaching, so I'm going to let her testify to the Lord, and then I'm going to preach here in just a minute. I believe God will help us.
Amen.
Stand for the reading, but you've been standing and worshiping the Lord, and I trust that you have respect for His word. So unless you just feel like it's a conviction of yours to stand, I'm going to let you be seated and read you part of a text, and then I'm going to preach just for a minute, and I really do mean just for a few minutes this morning, on a subject that's not it's not really what you would call a Sunday morning subject. Now, obviously, yeah, that's better. That's sometimes kind of dry whenever you don't have that ambiance. I like that. But it's not really what you would call a Sunday morning type message per se. And really, we don't say that one is restricted to one time and one another, but we must be honest, humans have their own mentality of how things ought to be. And so I want to get into this and try to be very cognizant of the time, because we're after 11 now, but I feel I was searching for direction for this morning's service and have been thinking about it days in advance, because I knew we'd be kind of crammed once we got here, so I was trying to put some forethought into it, and this is what I felt. And so I want us just to, if we could kind of, sometimes whenever we preach, you know, it's kind of like almost a roller coaster. You have to go up and then get to the crest and then come down. Well, if we can just go past that lift and just start on the crest and kind of come down. Because I'm not really going to be teaching you or preaching to you anything you don't know already. But 1 Samuel 22, and I'm going to read verse number 1 and 2, and then skip over to 5, and then all the way to the end of the chapter. So 1 Samuel 22, and I'll say a few more formalities tonight. It is good to be back here again, and I'm glad this time I have my family with me. Seems like last year I came in, I flew in, I was just here just preaching, and that's it, and left. And so it's enjoyable to get to be here and have some fellowship with friends. Amen. 1 Samuel 22 and verse 1. David therefore departed thence and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brethren and all his father's house heard it, they went down thither to him, and every one that was in distress, and every one that was in debt, and every one that was discontented, gathered themselves unto him. Indebted, distressed, discontented, whatever facet, whatever application you choose to make, At the end of the day, they are all elements of our genuine humanity, right, of which you and I have no choice but to be encapsulated in, if you will, until the day the trumpet sounds or the day we draw our final breath. Suffice it to say, we're just human. Right. Amen? I'm sure they are not the only one in here tonight or this morning that will admit that. Amen. And all these people that had all these issues going on and all these problems gathered themselves unto him. And of course, we're talking about David, him. And he, David, became a captain over them. And there were with him about 400 men. Verse 5, it's almost like God sent a preacher with a positive word for David. The prophet Gad said unto David, abide not in the hole. That's talking about that cave. Depart, leave, get out of here, and get thee into the land of Judah. In the original Hebrew dialect, the word Judah literally means praise. And of course, most of us know that, but it does us well to have it reiterated.
Right.
Judah means praise.
Right.
So it's almost like the man came on and said, I understand you're human, and I understand you're dealing with problems and hurt feelings, and if I could just transform us or transfer us from there to today, it's almost like he said, I know you're dealing with these political issues. I know you're dealing with these people getting locked up for standing for their convictions, and I know you're feeling the pressures of life. But don't stay in that cave and isolate yourself.
Amen.
I'm still
Amen.
With you.
Amen.
Get out of that mentality and get back to what you know to be doing, and that's praising God.
Amen.
Verse 18, bear with me just a moment. Verse 18, and the king said to Doeg, same dynamic, same situation, just a little different. It's almost like this entire chapter and the few verses following in chapter 23 are dealing with this issue of giving God what he desires, and that's our praise and worship. And I'm going to add prayer in there because I believe it's a cyclical nature. 18, the king said to Doeg, turn thou and fall upon the priest. And Doeg the Edomite turned, and he fell upon the priests and slew on that day 85 persons, 85 people that did wear a linen ephod. And Nob, the city of the priest, smote you with the edge of the sword, both men and women, children, suckling, oxen, asses, and sheep with the edge of the sword. And one of the sons of Ahimelech, the son of Ahitub, named Abiathar, escaped. Escaped. He got out of that situation.
Yes,
I'm telling you right now, I believe we need to hang on a few more days, because we're fixing to escape this stuff that we're in. And the Bible says he fled after David. Now, I'm not making David God, but I'm using that as a parallel for this service today. In this context, Saul may have been the king because of position, but David's already been anointed, and David is actually the king.
Right.
It's kind of like little T versus big T. Saul might have been, just if you look at me and let me just make an expression, Saul might have been the king. David, in actuality, was the king.
Right. Right.
Man comes on, preaches him out of that situation, and then later on down the road, we find Abiathar saying, you know what, man, and I'm going to give you this. I'm just giving it to you up front. This is what I'm preaching. He said, you may kill everybody else here, and you may steal all their joy and all their praise and all their positive outlook on everything, but you know what? I'm getting out of this. Where do you think you're going?
Yeah.
I'm going to find out where the king is, and that's where I'm going.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Fled after David. You want to, if you feel like it with me, just turn. It's just one verse, but it's in the very next chapter. Verse 6 of chapter 23, 1 Samuel. And it came to pass when Abiathar, the son of Ahimelech, fled to David to Keilah, that he came down with an ephod in his hand. Long story short, an ephod is something that priests wore, the Levitical priesthood in the Old Testament, and I don't have time to dwell there and explain all that, but in this context, it's speaking about a garment that was worn in the context of praise and worship and giving of ourselves to one that loves us more than we could ever imagine. That's what this ephod is. So let's, rather than say, well, I don't know anything all about that, so I don't know how much I can glean, just understand we're talking about a garment, or in this context, a mentality that we can put on when we come here. You know what? This is my ephod. We don't have to come in and wear all this liturgical garments anymore, but I believe we need to put on a mindset living for God and say, I don't care what happens, I don't care what comes my way, God's going to take care of me. I wish I could get a witness. God's going to take care of me, and God's worthy of my very best. Amen. Now, I want to give you my title, and I promise you, in my humanity, I'm not going to be very long this morning. If God wants to work, God can work. But I want you just to stay with me and let me connect these dots very quickly, and God's going to help us. I'm going to preach on the subject for just a few minutes. Save your ephod for the King. Save your ephod for the King. You can continue to remain seated, but I really want you to close your eyes, and I want us to pray for the next few minutes of this service. Can we do that?
God, we need you right now, our authority, by your power. Lord, we need you to move into this house.
God, we need you. God, I feel like somebody in here needs some direction. I feel like they need to be maybe turned around from a mentality this morning that because of the situation of the world around us, that they just can't get anything done. They're not going anywhere. They're spinning their wheels, so they might as well pack it up. They might as well give in. Well, I'm here to serve notice, God, this morning, that the devil is a liar. God, I feel like you would have me say that. The devil's a liar. We love you, Jesus. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you adoration. And I just wonder, before I begin to preach this message, I just wonder if you would just say, in Jesus' name, and then let's clap our hands like we really believe he loves us and like we really love him. Come on, like you really love him. I mean, not for the mayor of Abilene. I'm talking about Jesus right now. Come on. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Bear with me just a few moments, and the Lord is going to help us. Many years ago, I heard a story, and I never have forgotten it. And because I found that the tenets and the aspects of the story were so very poignant to where I was in life then, and especially so now. And I don't think that you can build a ministry off of a story, but there are things, it's almost like parables that we read in the New Testament. I think there are things that happen that you can look at and you can glean from, and you can say, man, that's just kind of where I'm at right there. And so, to make a long story short, let me just give you the top end dynamics of this. Many years ago in Western Europe, and of course, if you know anything about history, you've heard of all this to the Dark Ages and all, and they called it that for a reason, because it was very bleak and very dark. But in this time period in Western Europe, there was a situation of tumult, war, rumors of war, negativity, depression, oppression, darkness, bleakness, tempest, storms of life, as it were, begin to rage and begin to wage war on the peasantry of Western Europe. And so, in the middle of this tumult, and when we're talking about, I mean, wars and just senseless killings, and I hope that the more I talk, the more you're going to start understanding where we're at, because as I said, I really don't want to have to take a whole lot of time, but I want to say that you recognize, because we all in here have been blessed, you can't live without a brain, so we all have one. You can understand what we're dealing with in the time we live now. Wars, rumors of wars, and I'm just going to say this. I don't know where you stand on all of it, but I'm going to say it, and I'm going to say it openly. It's whether it's black, it's white, it's yellow, it's green, it's Hispanic, or whatever. I'm going to tell you, this killing and this foolishness is a bunch of senseless stuff. I wish I could get a witness now. It's senseless. Because I'm going to tell you, when I look at humanity, I really don't see those dynamics. You know what I see? I see people that are real people that need a real God to really love. Where they're from or what they look like or who their family is or what color. I don't say, well, that's a good killing, but that's a bad, or that's a good situation. I'm going to tell you, when it comes to humanity, we all have needs and we all have souls, and we're all going to spend eternity in the same place, so we might as well learn to love one another right here and now. Too strong, and that deals with serious issues of life. You gotta leave that stuff alone. No, I believe we need to approach that, because we're in a nation that wants to try to paint us or try to pit us against one another and try to paint one in a corner. And I'm just gonna tell you this morning, I don't know. There's some new faces in here, but I love all of you.
Yeah,
here you go.
Amen.
I love all.
Right.
But it is a black situation, a dark situation. And these wars begin to break out, and senseless killings and thievery and robbery. And you could just, you know, we could take an hour to talk about that.
Right.
But it is very, very, very depressing.
Yes.
Very oppressing.
Yes.
And a group of men. Now here's the hook. So we got through that and laid that foundation of the story. Here's the hook. A group of men that were very talented minstrels,
right,
began to travel from city to city,
right,
because they got together and said, you know, it's so dark and it's so tempestuous, it is so horrible, and these people are so depressed, and life is just got them down. I'm just gonna. Can I? Let me say this. This is probably not a good introductory to this revival, but I'm just gonna say it this way. Am I the only one sometime that just life ever just gets you down?
No.
Oh, come on now. Come on, somebody. Am I the only one that life ever? I'm not talking about living in depression. I'm not talking about living in negativity. But there's some days I just get up and I'm just frustrated, because you know what? I love God so much, and I think everybody ought to love the Lord. I think everybody ought to know who He is.
All right. Yes, sir.
But they said, you know, we got this talent. Just stay with me a minute. We got this talent. We have this ability.
Yeah.
So we might as well band together. And we might as well travel around from community to community.
Right.
And maybe something we sing or play,
right,
can make these people feel better about the situation that we are in now.
All right. Come on.
I'm going to tell you something. We've got the truth.
Yes, we do.
We've got a God.
Yes.
We've got a message.
Right.
I don't think we ought to be ashamed of that. I think we ought to travel all over and just tell somebody, what they told you. Let me tell you, it gets better than that. And I know what this one's saying, but it gets better than that. And I know what that doctor said, but it's better than that. And I know what that philosopher said, but it's better than that. I know what that politician said, but let me tell you, it's so much better than that. Oh, I'm going to tell you something. What I'm saying is more than just words. I'm telling you, it's better. Jesus loves you. He knows you. He knows your family. He wants to take care of you. So they do this, and they're pretty successful. And so, and I don't know the exact numbers, but for the sake of making a point for you to understand, I'm just going to throw some out to you. It's kind of like, and again, I'm not exactly 100% certain what the numbers were, but it's as if, according to this story, kind of like, say, they would go in. And just let me throw a number, say 200 at you. They'd go in and man, it'd be flocked, and 200 people would be in there.
Yeah.
Because you see, whenever things are going, when they're not going the way you want them to go.
All right.
And whenever they're looking bad, and whenever it's like Isaiah said, gross darkness upon the earth, gross darkness upon the people. Whenever it gets like that, You know, I don't want the economy to tank. I'm not a negative preacher, right. But I will tell you this. Now, you take what you want out of this.
Right.
You know, when somebody said, well, it was Azusa Street that Pentecost really hit its stride. You know, that's not true.
No, sir.
Azusa Street kind of made Pentecost explode
right. All
across the United States, but it didn't hit its stride. You go look at the history. Truth never hit its stride until after the Great Depression.
All right, go.
I'm telling you, go read those revivals. My grandfather was born in 1929, the year that the stock market crashed. I'm not a negative man. I'm not saying we need that. The point that I'm making. Right.